happened because the Lord gave me some revelation this week that I wanted to share, and I'm winging it. I don't want to read. I don't want it to be about me or anything, so I'm trusting the Lord to just let what needs to come out, come out. I know I think a lot of times about revelation. To me, revelation is a greater understanding of Christ, and the relationship becomes a little bit more intimate because it has more meaning to you. So I want to encourage anybody, if God gives you something, a greater depth to a scripture, if he speaks to you and you can't find the exact scripture, but yet you know it's God, share it. Because I think it helps everyone in different ways. Because when I think of revelation, I think a couple things. I think sometimes people share a revelation. I told my mom, I already shared it with her. And I said, I didn't want to because it sort of loses its, you know. Because when it's fresh, it's like sitting there and you can't wait to let it out. And I already shared it, so it's lost a little. And it just is, which is corny, but that's just me. I think sometimes people share revelation, and then some people hear it and they think, what are they talking about? And that's okay, because they've still heard it, and it's there. And then there are other people that get it up here, but it's not revelation to them yet. But at the same time, they've received it. And then I've found myself numerous times amongst all of us, somebody has shared something. And then a few months later, weeks later, days later, somebody shares something that's revelation to them. And you're thinking, yeah, that's what I said, or that's what she said, or, you know. So we're all in a different place, and that's okay. I think it's very important that we share our revelation so that those seeds are in there and that we all grow and we can all become more intimate and more in tune with what God put us here for. So I've had some things going on in my life that I really wasn't going to talk about, but I'm going to share a little bit of it in hopes that sort of by maybe a little bit walking in my shoes for me telling you, maybe you can join me in this revelation that it'll be more, you know, revelatory to you. So I shared a couple weeks ago about the stuff that we had gone through with Dan going to the VA and how God had allowed me to see through his eyes. I mean, I felt the love coming out of me, but yet I wasn't consciously thinking, I gotta love them, or what can I do to have an effect on them? It just happened. And so then from that time to this time, I continued to be my normal self, but yet I had this overall sort of well-being feeling going on that I couldn't explain. And so then one day at work, I'm just talking, and the fellow that I've been witnessing to was talking about fighting. He was going to fight for his job. He's about to become a regular, and he wanted to be at Pleasant Hill, and I'm going to fight for it. And I don't know why, but I just looked at him, and I said, I don't fight for anything. He does my fighting for me. And I said it three different times because he kept saying, God gives you the wisdom and the oomph to fight. And I said, I don't fight with anyone or anything. He does my fighting for me. I said it three times. And oddly enough, that very same day, I got a call from my dad. And I'll try not to go into too many details, but kind of give you an idea of what was going on. He wanted to talk to me. And so,
can we stop and then go back?
Yes. In Jesus' name.
She's here.
God, in your name, Jesus.
Her daughter.
In the name of Jesus. Yes, everyone, let's just pray right now. God, in the name of Jesus, you are all powerful and you know all things. God, that you speak life into this situation, God. That what the devil meant for evil, that you mean for good, and that you only speak life into this situation. God, we stand on your word, and you said that we can trust in you and know that your word doesn't come back void. So we speak life into this situation and expect a wonderful testimony, God, and lives will be touched and moved by this. God, in your name, Jesus, we believe you, Lord. Bless her and encourage her, God. Lift her up, and that only your word is spoken in this situation and what you desire. Life in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, life, life. You are life, God. And all things are created by you. Jesus. The devil's a liar. He's such a liar. And here's the thing, guys. He's already lost. Enough already. Why we let him jerk our chain and move us around and get us upset. It's not us. It's Christ that lives in us. He's lost. It's done. We simply get to be Christ and him to everyone and speak life into these situations. I believe you, God. I believe you, God. I believe your word. Jesus. Okay. Because I believe only good from this, I'm going to continue because the devil's a liar. So, back to my dad. He wanted to talk to me, which is a little odd. He doesn't typically talk to me about business. He's always joking and kidding around. And so I met with him. And he, when him and my mother were still together, they bought 55, 56 acres with the plans that someday, should something happen to them, all four of us kids that they had together, I have three brothers, would get a fourth. So, you know, like 13, 14 acres or the value thereof. And so through the years, he has sold lots to various people. He sold land to two of my brothers, and then he sold to one and another one for them to have their business out there. So little by little, what is his has gotten smaller. And I have gone to him and asked, can I buy, can I do this, whatever, and was always told no. Which, as I've been growing, I mean, obviously, I'm a lot closer to the Lord now than I was, and I'm learning more things about what it's about, but hard feelings that I've had to learn to deal with and get over, because I'm human. And so what he was asking me was my opinion or what I thought, and would it be okay? He wanted to sell what he had left to my two youngest brothers who have the business so that they could do some various things, wanted to put some cows on the property, blah, blah, blah. And I said, they already do that. I mean, they already put cows on this property and do all that. I'm like, what do they need it for? And I will be honest, I threw a little fit. You know, it's not fair. We're all adults. I said, I'm getting screwed. This is ridiculous. I'm going to get nothing. And like I said, I threw a bit of a fit. And so I left. And then I went to a birthday party at my sister's, and I vented to her. And what I want to say about venting is something that I've learned since then. When you vent, what you do is that person agrees with you, or you end up forming a support system. It does nothing to change you. And we're to be changed into his image. And we're supposed to be an example of him. So this thing's God's been, through these weird situations, God's been explaining these things to me. And when I finished venting to her a little bit, I said, I'm just going to pray about it. And so then I dropped it. And I did pray about it. And what I felt the Lord tell me was, you need to go apologize to your father. And instantly, I was in agreement with the Lord. I was okay with that. I didn't argue with the Lord. I just felt like I knew that was the right thing to do. What I was going to say or what needed to be done or why was irrelevant. I just knew, okay, God, I'll go apologize. And from that point on, how I have felt is a bit bizarre. And so I went to my dad and I told him, I said, look, I owe you an apology. I handled that very poorly. And I said, but here's the deal. I'm still a work in progress, but what I know is that I was created in his image. And I said, and what is his image? His image is love. I said, I love you and I love my brothers. I'm not fighting about anything. And I said, in a perfect world, you and my mother would have stayed together. If you something would have happened to you, eventually I would have gotten 13 or 14 acres, whatever. I said, in a perfect world, but it's not a perfect world. And I said, and the fact of the matter is, you're still alive, and it's still all yours. So what you choose to do with it, go to Prairie Meadows and squander it all, that's your business. If you want to sell it, it's your business. I have no hurt feelings. I'm not angry. I said, I love you. And I said, and it's not about that. The Bible says if you gain the whole world and you lose your soul, I mean, what's the point, right? And so I said, and I'm not sitting around hoping and wishing someday that if something happens to you, I'm going to have some money or whatever. I said, I quite frankly think you're going in the rapture, so I'm not going to get it anyway. And I said, and if something happens, I said, God is my source. If I get something from you, God's still my source. If I get nothing from you, God is my source. I mean, this is not, and so I guess all the things that I shared to him, I felt like I was trying to show him what true love is. Because I've also been studying, because of that, what is love? Love isn't haughty. It's not jealous. You want the best for the other person. It's not about you. It's about them. And that's what he created us to be. What we think of love come from Adam. And it's, I want, I need, how can this benefit me? What, you know, how it affects me. And that is not what love is. Despite all the horrible things they did to Christ, he still loved. I mean, he broke bread with them and he loved them, knowing every one of them was going to betray him. And so I guess I said all that to say that going through that in my head and all week long at work and continuing to deal with things with Dan, and I've only witnessed withdrawals and someone who is withdrawing from something on TV or heard other people tell their stories and how awful it is. And there has been such a peace in our home. It's a God thing because it's so indescribable. And I'm walking around at work on Tuesday, and I went to go talk to my mom afterwards because I'm walking around, I almost feel taller. And in my head then, as a human, I'm trying to rationalize all this. I'm trying to think, you know, why do I feel this way? Almost euphoric. I still have my normal 52-year-old aches and pains going on, but yet I'm not paying attention to them. I mean, they're still there, but yet it was like I wasn't aware of them. And I'm walking around, and everybody that I talked to, I could see how my smile affected them. One woman was crying, and I simply spoke to her and helped her, and I could see her whole countenance change. And so as I'm standing there, case in the mail at work, I hear, and I'm thinking, what is going on? Why am I feeling like this? I heard God say, and he said it to me three different times because I kept questioning. He said, you are all things to all people. And this is coming from someone who I have spent the better part of my entire life thinking I wasn't pretty enough, wasn't smart enough, wasn't talented enough, wasn't, you know, had poor self-esteem and all of this. And I'm thinking, all things to all people? What are you talking about? And again, he said, you are all things to all people.
Amen.
And I thought, okay. Because what does he say? As my Father sends me, I send you. You and I are one. As he is, so am I in this earth. So guess what? Just my very presence, without me consciously doing anything or thinking about anything, I am peace to the storm. I'm comfort to those who mourn. I am the answer to every situation or every place that I step. The reason I work, you know, I've thought about this. I thought, why do I have to go to work? I am not working for the money because God is my source. I am not working because you have to or you're supposed to. I am working because God gave me that job because those 100 people that I interact with are the only I am the answer, or I am what they need. Because I got to thinking about it. I thought, well, if I didn't work, what would I do? I'd sit at home. And all this that I know, all who I am, what good does it do amongst the four walls? We are to go out. So I go to the job. I go to the grocery store. I go to the VA. I go to these places because I am all things to all people. And because I sort of subconsciously know that, my shadow heals people. I mean, that's how it happens. It's not because when I walk into a room, I think, now how am I all things to all people? Because I still don't think I'm all that in a bag of potato chips. You know, I mean, I just think that knowing who I am and being secure in that, I am all things to all people. So when I wake up in the morning and I start to feel a little, I don't want to go to work, but then I think, I'm all things to all people. They need me. They need me. And so it has changed my whole perspective on what we're here for and makes so many things seem not important. I mean, because it really isn't. That's not why we're here. Because I'm also reading a book about the rapture. And quite frankly, I think we're going to have to go through some stuff, and we're getting down to the nitty-gritty. And if we don't step up and know that we are all things to all people, how is all of that going to happen? How is the rapture going to take place if we don't step up and show and fill the earth with his glory? And so I guess just what the revelation, all that to say this, is we are all things to all people. We have to stay conscious of that. The devil is a liar. He has no authority over us because we already have the victory. We just have to step up. And I found myself even, I went to PetSmart and I passed a woman. We didn't even make eye contact, but I noticed she was carrying a little oxygen tank and I started giggling. And God said, you're all things to all people. She walked through your shadow. I mean, really, we should start expecting stuff like that to happen because that is who we are. And we're all powerful. We are all of those things. And so I just want to encourage everyone and remind yourself, hey, I'm all things to all people.
Amen.
Anyway, so. Anyone have anything else to share? Yes.
I'd like a copy of the book you're reading.
Okay. I can do that.
I was online with Randy Clark. I listened to different things, and he's a good instructor, and he come on with the subject of impartation.
Because the Bible says the devil goes around seeking whom he may devour. So he's roaming around looking for a landing strip. So, you know, if you go, oh, I got that. You've just given him a little landing strip, and he's going to land in there, and he's going to continue to help you think about how awful it is or how bad you are. I mean, because here's what the devil did. After I got done throwing my fit with my father, then, you know, then it's all about me, and I'm thinking how I'm getting ripped off and how shortchanged I am. And so then I start thinking, and I've got the smallest, yuckiest house of all my family. I mean, they got really nice houses, and mine needs lots of repairs. And so, and then the devil, and when, because I gave him a landing strip, the devil continues, and then, you know, and compared to everyone at church, you probably have the shabbiest place, and, you know, and he just keeps going. But the minute I said, nope, I'm going to pray about this, and once I knew I needed to stop because that's not who I am, all of that went away because it's not about us, and we need to get our focus off ourselves.
Right.
And just focus on him,
right?
Because we are all things to all people.
Yes.
Anyone else?
Yes.
Mike.
Your prayers lifted up for Cindy. She may get released today.
She will.
There still are situations where it requires oral surgery and stuff, but praying for the infection and praying for the infection and the inflammation to be gone. There are shards of bone in there that apparently is pressing against nerves and stuff, and they did a CT scan yet this last night to see what's going on. She's online right now. She says hi to everybody. She's believing God will touch.
Amen.
Three things came to mind. Those shards, I saw two things, either dissolve or she basically spews them out of her mouth when
mm-hmm.
they get ejected. But Suzanne brought up another thing. Maybe these are roots for new teeth to grow right in place.
Mm-hmm.
So we're believing in that also. Second thing is, and I've seen this year after year after year, Winter Jam, where the enemy comes in and tries to steal the seed of those that gave their heart to Christ. Pray for a covering for all those that gave their heart to Christ Friday night at Winter Jam, that they would not be taken away from those that gave their hearts to the Lord Christ.
Amen.
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 Thank you, God.
Jody?
It goes in line with what you're saying. It's the Holy Spirit. So
mm-hmm.
I've been going kind of through the same things, grumbling, mumbling about getting up for work and going there. And God always reminds me it's your mission.
Mm-hmm.
You are the God for them in
mm-hmm.
place.
Mm-hmm.
So it's funny that you say that. But last Sunday I shared that, you know, God told me he healed my body.
Mm-hmm.
And these symptoms that have come upon or trying to come upon me again, I've been, you know, down in the dumps where you flesh again,
mm-hmm.
like you said, why me, Lord? Why am I going through? And all he said to me was, get up and take control of the situation. Get up.
Exactly.
You are.
Exactly.
You are what it is that's going to stop. So I told my husband, and I texted him, and I said, every hour we're declaring my healing.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
The next day, I feel just as good as I have in a very long time. But when I was going through that, and what you were saying about, you know, I've got the smallest house, and I was asking God, you know, why is this? And he took me to the scripture where they were saying to the blind man, I think, was it his mother that sinned? Was it he who sinned?
Mm-hmm.
He said, no, that I may be glorified
yes.
in this situation.
Yes.
So with me, with everybody else going through something, God is going to be glorified in the situation.
Yes.
Not that he wants us going through those things.
No.
But at the same time, it's a
glory.
Testimony
yes.
for the world and the people
absolutely.
Around us. So,
absolutely.
Anyway,
yes.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
You know, and I was just thinking, not only did I share that with my dad, I've gotten to speak to my sister-in-law and my sister and my husband and even my mom from where I'm at and from what the Lord has given me or whatever. So, you know, it's like love, 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 love. And they're like, I don't know how. And I said, it's God. It sure ain't me.
Yes.
It's God. So
yes.
just... Yeah, just walk in it. Yes.
Yeah.
Rita.
Yeah, I appreciate Mike saying that about, you know, the ones that went to
mm-hmm.
Winter Jam. My granddaughter and her friend had
mm-hmm.
went.
I saw that.
And I wasn't really expecting to go, but Kennedy had mentioned to me, are we going to go?
Yes.
And I'm like,
bless her.
Because my daughter wasn't able to go, her
mm-hmm.
mom, but Kennedy still wanted to go.
Good for her. Yes.
And I said,
uh-huh.
If you want to go, we're going to go.
Yeah, that's
yes.
awesome.
I wanted to make sure, really, that she got there.
Exactly.
Me, not so much. I mean, yeah, I enjoy it, and I like going, but
right.
God
Yes, he's moving in her. Yes, yes,
happen.
Exactly.
And I had already started feeling something Thursday night within myself.
Mm.
I mean, I know there are people here who have experienced that, to where you can't explain it,
right.
But you know that
yeah.
it is the Spirit of
yeah.
God
sure.
in you.
Exactly.
Doing something.
Exactly.
Yes.
Right.
Exactly.
And, you know, either praying through you or just, for me, it's crying and
yeah.
knowing that God is doing something.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Just being thankful because He is doing something
yes.
with His Spirit.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
But the thing that happened, and the girls were going to be here this morning, but Kennedy ended up with a temperature this morning. But I was going to share this with them here, too. Because they have it where they can say the prayer of,
mm-hmm.
You know, confessing Jesus
mm-hmm.
yes.
as their Savior.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard them both.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
I wasn't anything but being a witness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got to be a witness.
Yes,
yeah.
that's awesome.
And that's the way I felt.
Yes,
yes.
that's
I was
awesome.
A witness
yes.
to what God was doing.
Yes.
I didn't really expect it. You know, we always hear we should expect it.
Exactly.
Right.
But God does.
Yes,
right.
yes,
yes,
He does.
Yes,
yes
He
does.
That's what
He
did.
Yes.
And the scripture that I wanted to speak out this morning is that if you confess with your mouth
mm-hmm.
the Lord Jesus
yes.
and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved.
Yes.
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 And that's what they did.
Mm-hmm.
And my words don't really say it as big as it is, because it is bigger than
yes.
what I
oh, absolutely.
Amen.
And Woo. I am just so thankful.
Yes.
And Kennedy's friend, when we were leaving, she said, she just felt so good, and you could see it. But I mean, she's one that has a good time. She was dancing and, you know,
mm-hmm.
just
yeah.
enjoying the music. She said, and I learned so much.
Yes.
And she was just so,
oh, bless
so happy.
Amen.
And she was ready to come to church.
Awesome.
Yay.
Awesome.
So, they'll be here.
Yeah.
Yes.
yes.
That's awesome.
Lord.
Yes.
Praise
yes.
Lord. Glory.
Anyone else?
Jesus, glory.
Suzanne.
Okay, so we were leaving church last Sunday, and my heart is so great for all the needs, and they just keep coming. And it's not okay.
Right.
It's
yeah,
not okay.
I agree. Yeah, I agree.
My best friend lost her mother in a house fire last night. These things are not okay.
No.
And last Sunday, I was feeling overwhelmed before any of this stuff happened. And I was walking out, and I was just talking with Sarah and Eric and Mike and Michael. And I said, you know, I said, I believe the Lord has something special for the first of every month this year.
Yes.
Not only is 2017 going to be a great year, but every month, expect something
yes.
unexpected.
Amen.
Every
Amen.
Month.
Jesus.
There's going to be a new blessing, a new outpouring,
yes.
the first of every month.
Yes.
Yes,
and God has nothing but good for us.
That's exactly
yes.
right.
I am so overwhelmed with this darkness, but I'm telling you, the
yep.
Lord has put that song in my heart.
Yep.
Let there be light.
Yes.
Yes.
Let there be light.
Yes.
It is
yes.
our job to light up this darkness.
Yes. Yes.
To grieve with those who grieve, but to be in peace
yes.
for those who grieve.
Amen.
To be
oh,
loved for
peace
those,
of the
those
storm.
Who are lost.
Yes.
But I'm telling
yes.
you, there is some gross darkness. Even our
That's
small body
exactly
of Christ
right.
here this morning. But God
That's
says
why.
It is our job to light up the darkness.
Yes.
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 With
yes.
love and
yes.
hope
yes.
and
yes.
peace.
Yes.
Exactly.
That's right.
Exactly.
We are all things to all
yes.
yes.
We are. And it is our
yeah.
job to
yeah.
make sure
yeah.
that that
yes.
darkness
yes.
rolls
yes.
out.
Yes.
It has
to yes.
go. Yes. It has to go right
yes.
to yes. It can come. The devil can come. The enemy can come. But he has no right,
right.
to stay.
That's
he
exactly
has
right.
no right to claim anything.
That's
because
exactly
right. Jesus Christ
free.
Came with His blood.
Yes.
Came
yes.
with His blood.
Yes.
We are blood bond.
Yes.
Our victory is blood bond.
Yes.
I am
yes.
done.
Yes.
I am done.
Yes.
continuation in the miraculous recovery that she's experiencing.
Yep.
And the food situation, I know Sarah and Suzanne were spearheading that with Sally. The Abundant Life group on Facebook, if you don't know what it is, talk to me after service. Communication is the key.
Amen.
So.
For all things, not just the food situation, for all things.
Yep.
Yes.
So,
yeah, relative to that, Suzanne and Mike have taken some food over to Sheila and John today. I believe Sarah and Eric have already been over one, at least once. Sal brought some too, and then we've also got some food and someone in the church anonymously gave money for Myron's medication.
Right.
And we also have food that Alvin and Carol have,
praise the Lord,
agreed to take over to them,
mm-hmm.
or to him. So, you know, praise the Lord, and like I said before, you know, look, this is, I don't want to sound at all negative, but sometimes the way people express things, it just doesn't come across quite the way we would like it to come across. So if you want to do something for any of these people, just do it. Don't worry about, you know what I'm saying? Don't
right.
worry about the request.
Right.
Just do what you can do.
Yeah.
Sure.
Right. And that's
right.
all that matters. And, they'll be taken care of. That's the
yes,
main thing. And in the meantime, in the gap here where they're going through these situations, God will provide through us.
Yes.
And we'll see to it. It gets to them. And
amen.
In that way, everybody. You know, nobody wants to be under an obligation because it takes the fun out of giving.
Right.
And I'm not saying that anybody was trying to obligate anybody. It's just that sometimes the way things are said, it seems
right.
that way.
Right.
And I don't want anybody to get the wrong idea. You just, you give what you can give,
mm-hmm.
however you feel led to give.
Amen.
It'll all be good in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
All
amen.
Are being met right now.
Yes.
And we're grateful for that. We have some things for Mike and Cindy, and Mike refused it. What I mean by you can be
redirected.
I said that. Redirected. You have to cross your eyes to get the other person's point.
Yeah.
Make it clear.
Amen. Glory.
Too
funny.
They're doing good, and Mike, you know, generously wanted to just pass that on to one of the other families that needed
glory.
It, and they're doing well right now. So
Jesus.
Thank the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
And thank all of you that are helping, that are praying about this, and
yes.
that are actually stepping up and doing something that's great. Appreciate
that's
it.
What it's
amen.
About. James.
Well, the unexpected is, I mean, I went back to work and even to move around, but I don't know why they're doing so good on Saturday, and I'm hoping somebody can encourage them to try to be doing good on the weekdays so I don't have to overwork myself. I hope that somebody would step up that plate. I'm trying to tell them, you know, if I have the energy Saturday to help them like that, why not, can't they can, you know, just as good on the weekdays? I'm concerned over that because I don't want to be overdoing myself. That's a situation. I hope that they can get through and be able to let Nadia in California have been talking to, and I just hope that she gets through. She's a stay-at-home mother and taking care of kids. I said, I'll pray for her. And, you know, we're there to experience that, just to work together, and we really need to bond together about this gut situation. North High, this is ridiculous and stuff. We need to have a representative somewhere in the schools, so that they don't have this push against what the devil wants. And we've got to get together in the community. I mean, if we're not together, even if we're, it doesn't work. It just shows that we've got to strive to stick together and help one another. In
amen.
Other words, what Mike was saying, it's unity.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Tim.
Yes, one thing the Bible talks about in Psalm 48, they translate a little different in some, but King James said God is beautiful in situation, beautiful for situation, and I always, when I read those three words, no matter what situation, God's always beautiful.
Amen.
In
yeah.
And we went to Salvation Army to look at, we like to just, you know, go antiquing and stuff, you know, and they had some portraits of Jesus. You know, and I don't know, I just was in there, and just the way he looked, it's like he was always looking at us. And he just like, just come to me as you are. I love you as you are. I've got plans for your life. You were born for a reason. For this time.
Amen.
I want you right here, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just so overwhelmed by that, you know. And then I had a situation at work, and it's like when God shows up, we need to see him. Sometimes we look at God when he does these big things in our life, you know, we buzz, well, that's God. But he also does those things that are little, but that we should still thank him for.
Mm-hmm.
But the other day I was out working, and I was having a student look up a trailer. Well, what happened is my cell phone, so it fell out of my jacket, and it was on the ground. I didn't know where it was at, you know, for sure. I thought, well, I put it somewhere else for that moment. But I said, well, let's go back down by the trailers and look, because I couldn't find it. And what had happened was it was snow in front of the trailer, and it fell out at that point, and the tire tracks were just on the edge of my phone. So if he'd been a little bit, a half an inch farther, it would have totally smashed my phone.
Wow.
And I just thought I had my cover on it, and I just thought, you know, I said, God, that was a miracle.
Yeah.
He just
revealed
any farther over, it would have totally destroyed it.
Yeah.
And I was talking to students, says, yeah, you lose your contacts, you lose,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
the pictures you have on it. I mean, it's like everything was smashed. I know. And I just picked it up and I said, you know, I'm going to keep that.
thing. I just, like Rita said, it's this feeling. If you're not here, you're missing out. God's going to move. God's going to do what he wants to do in these last days. And if you don't want to get involved and participate, you're the one missing out. Because people, through the years, you know, they've always wished they could go back to like the book of Acts, like where their shadows healed people and they laid hands on people and all these things. I'm telling you, what's about to happen will make that look crazy, silly, trivial. I mean, what God wants to do is going to be so unimaginable. So I just encourage you, please, please come and be involved and be used. Speak the word.
Yes.
Will you now invite us again that your people may rejoice in you?
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law.
Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. So no matter what you're facing today, I don't care what struggle you're facing, what situation, what thing that the enemy is dogging you with today, cast it off. Stomp on it. It's under our feet in the name of Jesus. The best thing we can do is not hide in a corner, but to praise him. In the midst of a valley that I'm standing in right now, I refuse to sit down. I will praise him. I will praise him. I will worship him. And I will glorify him. Because he is worthy of it. He is worthy of it.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Let's worship God right now. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name this morning, Lord. You are great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are the victory, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a big hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Tammy. I hope we weren't too much of a distraction running back and forth. But praise the Lord. Appreciate you sharing with us today, all of you. Thank you, worship team, Mike. Praise God. You know, the enemy would just love nothing better than every time he comes along with some new lie and attack to have everybody just fold up and break down and give up. But the devil's a liar. Yes. Hallelujah. And God has put something in us. I just call it a don't quit. It's the Holy Spirit, but it's just a don't quit. We just don't quit. Praise the Lord. So I want to get right into the Word of God this morning. Beginning in Joshua chapter 2, I want to read verses 1 through 4. You know, I can tell you, I don't want to make too many analogies and mixed metaphors and everything else, but I always freak out after services, you know. In fact, Breaking Bad is what I do at the beginning of every service, praise the Lord. But I just, you know, I was uncomfortable last week because I mentioned myself, you know, and I don't want it to be about me, but I mean, after all, I am. And so sometimes it's hard not to, but it certainly isn't about trying to, you know, lift myself up or magnify myself in any way. It's just that, you know, we're all in this crap and there's stuff we have to deal with. Amen. And I having spent some time in the Marine Corps and in combat, I can tell you something about warfare. And what you do in boot camp and in training is altogether different than what you do when you're in warfare. Right. It's to prepare you for that, but it really can't, because in the cold face of reality, it is like a slap in the face, and everything changes. And that's where we're at. You know, this isn't training camp anymore. No. It's warfare. Right. So you just need to grit your teeth and do what you've been taught. Yes. And we'll cry about it later. Okay? If there's any tears, they won't last long in heaven. Can't focus on the fright and the fear and get your job done. God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but a peace, love, joy, and a sound mind. We have to use that, amen. That sound mind is the mind of Christ. It's the mind that thinks the way God thinks and then therefore responds to the situations the way God would. You know, I'm not insensitive at all. I have my private moments, but I'm telling you, I've got the biggest sign in my office says, lose the drama. That's the byline of my life. I don't have time for drama. I'm not being unsympathetic. I'm not saying I don't have concerns and cares for people, but drama's got no place in this. Drama's something you pay to go to a theater and watch. It's not something we want to experience every day in our lives, but that's what the devil does, is try to continue to keep us in drama. Yes. And we got to move beyond that, yes. Praise the Lord. So I want to begin here in Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into the harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither to tonight to the children of the children of Israel to search out the country. The king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country. And the woman took the two men and hid them and said thus, there came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were. In other words, they came, but I don't know where they are. I don't know where they went, right? All right, let's go to Joshua chapter 6, verses 21 to 25. They utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, and ox and sheep and ass with the edge of the sword. But Joshua had said unto the two men that had spied out the country, go into the harlot's house and bring out thence the woman and all that she hath, as ye swear unto her. And the young men that were spies went in and brought out Rahab and her father and her mother and her brethren and all that she had. And they brought out all her kindred and left them without the camp of Israel. They burnt the city with fire and all that was therein. Only the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. And Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive and her father's household and all that she had. And she dwelleth in Israel even unto this day because she hid the messengers which Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. Now let's one more scripture here and we'll move on. 1 Peter chapter 2 verses 9 and 10. 1 Peter 2, verses 9 and 10. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Praise the Lord. Every Christian is called. Every Christian is anointed. Every Christian is gifted.
Yes.
Every Christian is called for the purposes of God.
Amen.
Called to share Jesus as the only Savior.
Mm-hmm.
Through his death and resurrection, we're saved from sin. We're saved from the penalties of sin. We're saved from the bondages of sin, and we're saved from the consequences of sin. And we're called to manifest, to proclaim, and participate in the kingdom of God here and now. Most Christians, however, are not engaged. In Rahab's time, during the few decades that encompass the book of Joshua, God was up to something extraordinary. And God is up to something extraordinary in our time right now.
Yes,
so there was the slavery of Israel and the exodus from Egypt, and God delivered Israel. He took them out of Egypt and then across the Red Sea, and he led them through the wilderness and brought them to Kadesh Barnea, which was right on the edge of the Promised Land. And this is where Israel was to enter into the promises and the rest of God. But remember, they failed. And they failed because of their lack of faith.
Mm-hmm.
Their refusal to believe God.
Yes.
They just didn't trust the Lord. They saw the circumstances. They saw the giants. They saw the walled cities. And they saw their problems bigger than their God.
Yeah.
Now the question today is your God bigger than your drama? Praise the Lord.
Yes.
This is no way meant to demean people that are going through stuff. Because every one of us are going, you heard some of my stuff this morning.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody's got this.
Yeah.
But is God bigger than this or not?
Yes.
And that's the question that's being asked to us every day, every time we're confronted with another attack of the enemy, another situation, another circumstance, another drama. That's meant to limit us, to challenge our faith, to cause us to not trust in God.
Yes.
Amen. God always blesses belief.
Yes.
And he always judges unbelief. And I know that sounds bizarre coming from a grace preacher. But let me explain what I mean by that. Look at John chapter 12, verses 47 and 48. If any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. So God judges, but he's not judging in the sense that we would judge. Think of it the way it was in Israel when God said, if you're a believer, put some blood on the doorpost and the lintel, and the death angel will pass you by. The death angel wasn't God. It was the demon. It was the devil. Amen. And the thing that protected these people from the demon's job, from the devil's job, which is to kill, to steal, and to destroy, was the blood.
Yes.
Amen. So there's a judgment that comes. It's not coming from God. But you either are blessed by faith or you suffer the consequences of unbelief, which is the enemy is able to have ability to attack and take advantage of you. That's the judgment we're talking about. It's faith or it's unbelief. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. I was talking to Sheila the day of her surgery, and, you know, we were talking about some of this stuff, and, God doesn't bring any of this junk. It comes because we're in a fallen world where the enemy still can manipulate and control people. But the truth is, everything that the enemy brings for evil, God is going to make something good come out of that somehow, some way. It may not be understandable to us at the moment, but somehow God has to bring a positive out of the negative because he's God. Amen? And so the scripture in Ezekiel says, I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land that I should not destroy it. But I found none. God went looking. And God's still looking.
Yes.
He found Noah, he found Abraham, he found Moses, he found Peter, he found Paul. God's still looking for someone who will respond to his call.
Yes.
In Joshua chapter 2 and 1, if you'll go back there again, Mike, Joshua 2 and 1. Everybody says, well, you know, but my track record's not that great. Look, I don't have time to start down my track record. It's ugly. Much of it is despicable.
Yeah.
Most of it embarrassing. Yeah. But it is in the past. It is history. It doesn't exist anymore as far as God's concerned, so it doesn't exist for me. I don't worry about it. I don't lay awake at night thinking about it. I'll leave that up to other people. They want to spend their time rehashing my life. Have at it. There's plenty there to hash. Praise the Lord. But Joshua, all I say is it just glorifies God that much more. Praise the Lord. So Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went, and they came into a harlot's house named Rahab, and they lodged there. So the first thing that you see is Rahab was a prostitute, and we read already that she was a liar.
Right.
They come and ask her, where are these guys? I don't know. I don't know any guys. They're not here. So she was a whore and a liar. So was it her moral character that made her ready and acceptable for God's purpose? Obviously not. The devil wants you to look at your issues, yourself, your stuff, and say, well, that's disqualified you. You may be able to teach a Sunday school class, but you're never going to be able to raise the dead. You're never going to cast out a demon. You're never going to be able to heal the sick. And that's a lie from hell.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Joshua chapter 2. Verses 8 through 11. In fact, God gets a tickle, if you will, use my verbiage, of just mocking the enemy.
Yes.
He loves to take the weak things to confound the wise,
yes.
the ignorance, you know, the feeble, the what the world would look at and say, well, that's a washout. That nothing's going to happen from them. And raise them up and use them for his glory. So that nobody gets the credit but God.
Amen.
Amen. So before they were laid down, she came up unto them on the roof. And she said unto the men, I know that your Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we've heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom he utterly destroyed. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. The Lord your God, he is God in heaven and in the earth beneath. Praise the Lord. Rahab believed God. She had faith as a lying prostitute. She had faith because of what she'd heard. Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now I want you to see how profound this is. Let's go to Joshua 2:10, if you can back up to that, Mike. She said the whole city had heard the stories. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. What you did under the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. We've heard it. And yet from the account, she's the only one in the city that believed. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Psalms 112, verse 7. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. We hear negative stuff all the time. We hear things that are supposed to put us into fear, cause us to curl up in the natal position and just whine away. But he said, when we get these things, our heart's fixed, trusting in the Lord. It's true today for Christians and for non-Christians. To Christians, I see it happen all the time. They hear the same message, look at the same scripture, and respond in opposite ways. One in faith, and the other just walks away sad or depressed or confused. One's transformed, and the other's unchanged. What Tammy was talking about when we talk about revelation. Just because somebody has a revelation doesn't make it your revelation.
Right.
That's why I don't spend a lot of time reading all the other books and listening to all the other tapes. I need revelation. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm not saying you shouldn't do that. And I'm not saying I never do it. I'm just saying I'm not going to get revelation from somebody else. I'm going to have to get revelation from God. And if I hear something that rings true, then the only way for that to become revelation is for me to act on it. Not to just store up more information.
Right.
And sometimes that's what happens in church. We hear stuff that may be revelation to somebody, but it isn't revelation to you until you act on it. It's just like the saying, receive the prophet, you receive the prophet's reward. You're going to be prophesied over from now till Jesus comes. Right. But if you never act on the prophecy, you might as well forget about it. It ain't going to happen. It happens when you respond to it, when you act out on that. Then it becomes yours.
Uh-huh.
It's not just random anymore. It's literally yours.
Uh-huh.
Matthew chapter 21, verses 31 and 32. And I'm not trying to be mean or, stiff-necked or hard-headed here. I'm just trying to be adult. And it's time that we all just, man up, woman up, and Christian up.
Right.
And act on who we are. Because this stuff ain't going away. In this world, you're going to have tribulations. If you think, we're just going to, it's going to go away and we just never have any more problems, get a clue. This will pass and something else will come. And we're going to have victory over every one of them. But the victory is ours in Christ. Not in our strength, not in our ability, but in Him. Focused on Him. On His reality. You say, well, how do I focus on Jesus? Yeah, I know there's pictures, but we know that they're really not pictures of Jesus. There's some artist rendering of what they assume Jesus to look like. This is the best picture and the only picture of Jesus you're going to get in this life. He is the Word. The Word became flesh. You want to focus on Jesus, focus on the Word, and you'll have Jesus. You'll have that reality working in your life. So, Harry says, whether of them twain did the will of his father. They say unto him the first, Jesus saith unto them, Verily I say unto you, that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not. But the publicans and the harlots believed him, and ye, when ye had seen it, repented not afterward that ye might believe in him. Now, repentance is not, you know, the grieving thing, it's changing your mind about God.
Exactly.
They had this legalistic, angry, vindictive picture of God in their mind, and when God comes up and expresses himself in love and in grace, they couldn't receive it. So they didn't get any part of the kingdom. But who did? These same people that they had marginalized and pushed off to the side and diminished and demeaned, all of a sudden they're the first in the kingdom. So I'm grateful I was a reject. Praise the Lord. I'm not sad about it. I'm not proud of it. But I like it. It put me in good company.
Yes.
Hallelujah. God said, I can use this mess.
Yes.
Amen. I can do something with this.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So look at Rahab's story. She embraced God's purpose. And she rocked her world. Literally.
Amen.
Yep.
Things would never be the same again. When the walls of Jericho came down, everything changed. You want to see the Great Commission accomplished in our generation? See the return of the Lord? It starts with faith. You want to see the realm of God now? Well, it's faith that's willing to open up and welcome the purposes of God that make that happen. Welcome the purposes of God no matter what. Remember, Rahab didn't have the end of the story. She was risking everything to hide these people because she believed God. It's easy to look at it in hindsight and say, wow, you know, what a lucky break. No, she could have easily been put to death, her and her entire family.
Yes.
Right.
So what God is up to in our lifetime is way bigger than our fears.
Yes.
What God is up to is way bigger than our uncertainty.
Yes.
It's way bigger than our problems, and it's way bigger than our drama.
Yes.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Everybody's got drama.
Yes.
Everybody's got limitations.
Yeah.
It's because we're human.
Yeah. Right.
Rahab's life was full of drama,
yep.
Full of liabilities,
yeah.
Full of limitations. She was a prostitute.
Yeah.
She was a woman in a time when women were no more than property. And she lived amongst the people, the Canaanites, that were pagans.
Right.
No value for life or anything else.
Right.
They had all of that against her. And yet, when it came to the purpose of God,
yep.
Her life was radically transformed.
Yes.
Come on.
Thank you.
Rahab was convinced about God's goodness.
Yes.
Rahab was convinced about God's plan.
Yes.
Rahab was convinced about God's power. I said before, you know, living in combat, living in war, is very different from living in peacetime or in safety. It's a whole different paradigm. And I mentioned one night here we were talking, and I said, you know, it's like you remember back World War II. Well, you probably don't remember back then. Very few of you might, but I don't remember it, but I read enough about it to know that they used to have all these posters say, loose lips sink ships.
Right.
That's why we have to guard our tongue.
Yes.
Yeah.
And say what God says.
Yes.
Right.
Instead of what our fears.
Yes.
And
right.
The enemy's trying to get us to say, oh my God, what's going to happen now? Oh, we're all going to die. This is terrible. It's never going to work out. It's going to be cancer. It's going to come to me because somebody else in my family had cancer and this and that and the other thing. And oh, we'll never have anything because my folks never had anything. So how can I have anything? And on and on and on and on. Loose lips sink us.
Yes.
We need to discipline the things that come out of our mouth to agree with Jesus, to say what Jesus said. Then we're projecting Jesus to other people instead of our own fears and anxieties. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. I can tell you this from the little experience I had in combat. You don't really sit around talking to each other about how scared you are.
No.
It's not that you're not scared. Everybody's scared and everybody knows they're scared, but it's just not something you're going to talk about.
Right.
You're not trying to feed that. You're trying to work the opposite. You're trying to show that I'm not going to succumb to fear. There's nothing wrong with being afraid.
Right.
It's what you do with the fear that makes the difference between people.
Yes.
Courage is just controlling fear. That's all it is. It's just not letting the fear control you.
Right.
There's nothing sinful or wrong or, you know, weak about having fear.
Right.
It's just what you're going to do about it, how you're going to handle it.
Yes.
God didn't give us the spirit of fear, but he didn't say you'll never have fear.
Right.
He said, I'm just looking to see how you're going to handle that fear.
Right.
You're going to trust me,
yep,
or you're going to believe the fear. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Life is a war.
Yes.
Because it's a constant fight. Sorry, I wish I could paint a prettier picture for you this morning. The bottom line is we are victorious. We are more than conquerors, but we are still in a battle. That's what he said. In this world, you'll have tribulation.
Yes.
In this world, you're going to be involved in warfare or you're going to be a victim.
Amen.
Come on.
You say, well, I don't like to fight. I don't like to fight either, but the only thing I like worse than fighting is getting myself whipped, getting beat up on. Amen? So you don't have to like the fight. You just got to figure either you're going to fight or you're going to become the victim of the fight.
Right.
1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 5. 1 Thessalonians 3 and 5. For this cause, this is Paul writing to Thessalonica, to the church there, and he said, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, he said, I couldn't take it any longer, I wrote to you to find out about your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you and our labor be in vain. I checked on your faith because I was afraid the enemy might have come in and stolen or robbed you of your faith with fear, with doubt, with whatever. Amen? The enemy is after your faith. He is doing the same thing to do today that he did 2,000 years ago. From the very beginning, it's always about stealing your faith, getting your faith. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can't get God to cooperate with you without faith.
Right.
Yep.
But with faith, the enemy flees.
Yep.
Because when you operate in faith, you're operating in Christ and not in your own strength,
yes,
and not in your own ability.
Yes.
Right.
So there's a war going on in the world. And it's not just in the Middle East.
Right.
It's not just in certain geographic locations on the earth.
Right.
But there's a war going on in the world, and it's between Christ and Satan.
Yes.
Right.
Now, Jesus has defeated him, but we are to make his enemies his footstool.
Yes.
Right.
Meaning we enforce those victories.
Yes.
Come on.
There's a war going on between truth and lies.
Yep.
Between belief and unbelief. Between grace and human effort.
Right.
Last scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. 2 Corinthians 4, 16 through 18. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory.
Yes.
While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are not seen are temporal. But the things which are, or the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Yes.
And I see this commercial, and I don't even know what the commercial is. I rarely pay any attention. I just see if it's something that I think it's funny or whatever, but I never pay any attention to what they're actually selling. But there is some commercial in the sky, and they say, we know that time is fixed, or time is infinite, that's the word. They say, we know that time is infinite, but why is it that we're always running out of it? Well, it's idiotic. It's coming from a stupid premise in the first place. Time, by definition, cannot be infinite.
Right.
If it was infinite, there wouldn't be time.
Right.
And every time I hear it, I just cringe. I think, who wrote that? What were they thinking? Praise the Lord. This is finite. But we are infinite.
Yes.
And we have to operate from the infinite or we succumb to the finite.
Yes.
Right.
That's what he's talking about. We either operate in the invisible realm, in the spirit realm, or we're going to get the crap beat out of us in the physical realm.
Yes.
The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. This battle is not flesh and blood. This battle is a spiritual battle, and you cannot win it in the flesh.
Right.
That's why it takes faith.
Yes.
Come on.
By faith, read Hebrews 11 sometime, and you'll see what we can do when we operate by the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
You may not have to die for Christ, but I promise you, when push comes to shove, you're going to have to live for Him. And that simply means living by faith.
Yes, Lord.
Believing in the invisible and not being lied to by the visible.
Right.
Let me wrap up with this. Rahab was the mother of Boaz. Boaz, you know, that made her, Boaz, you know, married Ruth. So that made her the great, 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 something like this, grandfather or grandmother of David. Now, Jesus comes into the world as the Savior through the ancestry of David. It's amazing God. He takes this lost, broken, messed up girl, a prostitute, and reveals himself to her so that she, by faith, is delivered.
Yes.
And then she, because of that faith that delivered her, helps to bring the ultimate deliverance to everybody.
Yes.
Yes,
Lord.
That's what can happen when you trust God.
Amen.
Say, well, that's Rahab. That's history. Listen, God is still looking.
Yes.
He's still seeking somebody. He's still looking for somebody that will stand in the gap. He's still looking for somebody that will put their confidence and their trust in Him so that He can continue to spread this reality, this truth, this salvation, amen, to everybody. So everybody gets the benefit from what we do. And by faith, we can pull down. There's walls, friends. I mean, you know that there's walls. But by faith, we can still do it. We can still bring down walls. We can still rock our world for Jesus, amen, and make a difference so that God will return, so that we will have Christ here, amen, and peace on earth, goodwill. The kingdom can come. The kingdom will come when we operate by faith in Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God. So I just challenge you to challenge the enemy.
Yes.
The next time he comes up and slaps you across the face, bust him in the nose.
Yes.
Don't just take it. Fight back.
Yes.
Fight back with faith, and he will flee. He just keeps throwing junk at us, trying to get us to back up and to withdraw.
Yes.
Amen. That's not the time to back up. That's the time to go on the aggressive. That's the time to take offensive action against the enemy.
Yes.
Right now, we're living in the last days. In the last days, he said, great darkness will cover the earth. But the light of the church, the light of God's body, His people, amen, is going to shine brighter and brighter and brighter. And the glory of the Lord will fill the earth the way the water covers the sea. That's a challenge for us to make it happen. Hallelujah. To be that light, amen, to bring the glory of God into the darkness so that God can shine forth in everybody's life. Amen. It's a battle. But we've got assurance that we have the victory. The victory is ours. We just have to stay in the fight. It's just like Israel moving into the promised land. The battle's not yours, he said, it's mine. I just need you to go. I just need you to show up, amen, and I'll take care of the fight, amen. So show up and believe that God's going to do something supernatural in every situation, amen. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you this morning. Appreciate your prayers. Amen. Let's just continue to bombard heaven over all of this junk and confess what God has already accomplished. for all of these situations and circumstances that are going on, and not only in our lives, but in the lives of the people that we know beyond the church. Eric.
Well, you're talking about drama today and how we deal with drama, and I think as Christians and traditionally in the church, it seems like we want to look at everyone else's drama and then judge why they're in their drama.
Yeah.
But the thing, like you were saying about Rahab, it wasn't that Rahab believed God, essentially, but it's that she acted and took action. And so, you know, there's a scripture, bear one another's burdens with love.
Right.
And I think we all need to think about the context of that as a mother and her baby's diapers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, she bears the baby's, you know, burdens every day. She changes the diaper. She takes the toxins that the baby's putting out of its body, and she gets rid of them. Mm-hmm. And she cleans the baby and refreshes it every day. And that's what Christ did for us.
Yes.
And expects us to be transformed to his image and do it for others.
Yes.
So the real problem with drama is not that these big dramas that we can't hide from other people and they see in our lives that break us, but it's the drama that keeps each of us from interceding in the other person's life and delivering
right.
them out of their
right.
drama.
Amen.
And that's the manifestation of Christ in us.
Yes.
You know, and it's about, like you were saying, boot camp. What it
yeah.
teaches you to do is it's not, you're not important in the scheme of things. It teaches you can deal with a lot more than you think you can deal with, that you're not that big of a deal in the big picture, and it purges out of you all the things that are going to cause you to react wrongly
right.
and not see your brother as more important. You know,
right.
like in the SEALs, they take, you know, 5-6 guys and they put a, you know, 400-pound log on their head. And like, you're going everywhere with these guys.
Yeah.
You know, and no one, it's a burden. It's too big for one person to bear.
Right. Yes.
And so the question God asks with faith is, are you going to do something?
Exactly.
And that's the big question.
Yeah.
You know,
will you
that's
sit and
what I'm
watch?
About, that's what
yeah.
I'm saying about
yeah.
grace, about
yeah.
revelation, about
yeah.
anything. It's not real until it's real to you, until you act on it.
Right.
And that's what
yeah.
this is all about. It's fine. Faith, we can talk about it in any way we want. We can define it in any number of ways.
Right.
But the bottom line is, are you willing to act on what God says or what he has said about any situation that you're confronted with or not? If you do, you're operating in faith, and you have the full assurance that God and all of his resources are going to be with you.
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise
so
God.
Let's get in. Let's instead of observing and being peripheral to the drama, let's create our own drama for the devil.
Exactly.
Let's give him some drama.
Right.
Let's produce something rather than just being, you know, the affected.
Right.
Let's be the effector.
Yes.
Amen. Let's
Amen.
Make some impact.
Yes.
Let's have an effect in the lives of other people,
yes.
loved ones, friends, and the strangers.
Yes.
It's the only way God's going to get released into this natural realm.
Yep.
Is through the supernatural.
Is
and we
true.
Have the, we're the only ones that can do it.
That's
There's
true.
A scripture that talks about. There's a scripture that talks about how that, you know, the unbeliever doesn't see God, doesn't understand God. We understand it, we believe, because we have the Spirit of God. But without the Spirit of God, they cannot see God. They can't understand God. They can't comprehend God. That's why the Spirit that we have, the Spirit of God, has to be released.
Yes.
Yes.
They have to have access. Because what it ends up being like this. This is my own interpretation. It's, you know, theologically you can argue with it, but I don't really care. So in the Old Testament, the Spirit would come and go.
Right.
And people would be influenced by it, but they couldn't keep it as a permanency in their life.
Right.
It couldn't really transform them other than momentarily from moment to moment. That's how I see us with sinners, with the unbeliever. We bring that Spirit. We have it constantly. It's always with
yes.
us. They don't have it. They don't have access to it without faith in Christ. So the only way they can get touched by it is by us interacting,
wow.
by us being involved, with us coming
right.
into their lives and touching
yes.
their lives. Then they can have an experience of the Spirit. It causes them to do just what you were talking about, Rita, with this little girl, is happy and feeling good. And why? She's been in the presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
My grandkids have been here. And we know they don't understand the theology. They don't understand necessarily the preaching. And to them, it's just kind of, you know, people shaking tambourines and getting loud. But they're in the presence. They're,
yes.
they're experiencing
yes.
the Spirit.
Yeah.
And it
yeah.
changes them. It affects them.
Yes.
And every time, that's why we try to get people to come to church,
yeah.
because we want them in that atmosphere where they
yeah.
can experience. But a lot of people are just not going to come.
Right.
So we got to go where they are and
yeah.
do the same thing there. Churches. Just a building where we get together. Church could be Walmart in the checkout
yes,
line. It could be anywhere.
Right.
this God thing that is in us. It's this won't quit thing that God has placed in us.
Amen.
That touches them and changes them and affects them. And that's why we have to just walk in the Spirit. Be willing.
Yes.
Be open so that the Spirit can. See, I think when Peter walked by in the shadows, that was just a guy had learned how to just walk in the Spirit, how to just really release what
yes.
was in him.
Yes.
It wasn't Peter. He said, don't look at us like it's something we did.
Right.
But it's the Spirit of God. It's,
right.
it's Jesus that has done this.
Yes.
Right.
And that's what people need. They need to, and God's doing it the same way. He's still operating the same way. He just needs us to get on board.
Yes.
Don't let fear stop you from doing the thing that will change this world, that will change everything so that God will return, so that we can all get past all this mess
yes.
and get the glory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the meantime, we can enjoy
yes.
this. We
yes.
can have a good time.